Welcome to our podcast again. My name is Marieke de Witte. I'm a clinical psychologist, sexologist working at Maastricht University. I'm teaching a lot on sexuality, doing research. And today we're going to talk about sex, about am I normal, about porn, about hypersexuality. So many interesting topics. And I'm going to discuss this with some guests. Maybe you can introduce yourself.
Yeah, hi, my name is Nico. I studied in Maastricht. I did my bachelor in psychology and also my master in health and social psychology. And yeah, I'm really happy to be here today with you.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Beatrice. I'm currently doing my third year psychology, still the bachelor's, and I'm writing my thesis on school-based sex education. So I feel very blessed to be here.
Okay, well, thank you for being here. Thank you for joining us again here on this podcast. And well, today we're going to address an interesting question. The question like, am I normal? Is what I feel normal? Is what I do normal? Are we doing okay as a couple? I watch porn every day. Is that normal? It's a question we get a lot. And it's really strange that people always want to be exceptional. But when it comes to sex, we all want to be normal and average. And it's actually really difficult to judge like, what is normal sexual behavior? Because everyone has their own unique love map. We have talked about this before. Everyone has their own unique sexual wishes. What works for you, what turns you on may be different for me. Mm-hmm. So it's really difficult to make these generalized statements and to make these uniform conclusions. But at the same time, this is what science does. We actually focus on averages. So there's a clear paradox between the science and then the reality of our sexuality, of our uniqueness. So that makes it a little bit difficult. And especially in times of COVID, there's a risk if we do research on sexuality that we create new norms. And especially in these times, people have questions. And so they're looking for answers. And there's a lot of research going on now on COVID and sex. And we also see that the media is eager to publish articles on this topic. And they want like polarized statements, but it's really difficult to give these polarized statements. So I think it's an important question that we just reflect on, like what is okay, what is average, what is normal behavior? And I think that's one of the topics we need to discuss today.
Definitely. I was thinking, I feel like also this idea of what is normal and everything, it's so linked to sexual myths, right? Like we create these ideas that then become norms and we always evaluate ourselves and our sexual behavior against those norms.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. And that's the thing. We these norms, we read them in magazines, on the internet. There's a lot of myths, like you say. Mm-hmm. And so that's how we create and construct our norms, like what is normal sexual behavior. And if we think about it, like how many times do couples need to have sex? There's kind of a norm, 2 times a week. There's like in a good relationship, you automatically feel what your partner wants, or sex pops up spontaneously.
So true.
Or what is also important, like if you fantasize about other people, then you're cheating. If you watch porn, then there's something wrong in your relationship. It's a signal that something is missing. There's so many ideas about what is okay in a relationship, what is normal.
Yeah, and I think also in a relationship, it's not only normal between people. So am I normal regarding to all the couples? Do we have enough sex? Do we have too much, too little? But also within a relationship, I think you go then through phases where you have more sex, less sex. Also, where's their normal? Is it normal to have a lot less sex or a lot more sex than before? So look at the within and also between people differences.
Exactly. Because that's what you say. I mean, a lot of like if there are sexual problems, they're often like a very normal reaction to a certain situation. If you have a lot of your mind, if it's a busy period, it's normal that sex is not a priority. So it is an important idea to reflect on that we have so many norms about sexuality, and it's often what you say based on taboos and myths and moral conceptions. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, we have to consider that there is of course behavior that we can say this is pathological, that it does not fit with social norms, or in the sense that it causes harm to others and to yourself, then we could say it's problematic. But there's really a thin line between what is normal and abnormal behavior, and that makes it also difficult to think about sexual problems or about dysfunctional behavior. For example, when we make this distinction between paraphilia and paraphilic disorder, because you can have a paraphilic interest, a fantasy about having sex with children, but as long as it's a fantasy and you know your moral judgment is okay, like, okay, this is not okay to have sex with children, and you have no issues with impulse control, you do not act on it, then in a way it's only a fantasy. So I think it's really difficult to judge fantasies of people, because a fantasy is it's very personal.
And to judge what is normal, because also when I think about these ideas that we all share together with friends about your sexual life, sometimes like I would speak to friends and they're like, oh, you know, I have sex like 4 times a week, and then the other one would say 2 times a week, and you see that there's like this degree of comparison and assuming that having more sex then is better than less sex. And yeah, like we know that sexual well-being, sexual health touches a lot upon our own general well-being, our self-esteem, our how we perceive ourselves as sexual beings. And so when there's this comparison, it can, a lot of feelings of incapacity can arise, I feel like, sometimes. So I think it's important to, whenever we talk to friends about sex, which is a super nice topic to discuss with friends, we don't do it from a place of comparison and from a place to like assess ourselves as sexual beings, but from a place of understanding and like sharing just with your friends how your sex life is, you know?
Yeah, exactly. It's really about creating your own norms. I think that is the most important. Just always compare yourself, with your own relationship, and not with what you see on the internet, what you read on the internet, what you hear from friends, because again, everyone has their own unique sexuality and their sexual wishes.
So would you say it's then more important to, instead of focusing outwards and seeing what should I do, to get more inwards and see, kind of getting in touch with oneself, what you want and your wishes, your desires, your feelings?
Yeah, what you consider to be normal, but at the same time, of course, it's also about what we consider to be normal, but it needs to be, I mean, you cannot cause yourself harm or others. Yeah. And if you feel distressed by it, then it's also a signal that there's something wrong that maybe, so I think that is important. But it's just the idea of that we just have so many moral judgment when it comes to sex, that so many things are not okay in our mind. But why is it not okay? Because we think, because we often, it's also, lack of knowledge, like the fact, like fantasies, for example. Everyone fantasizes during sex, or let's say maybe not everyone, but a lot of people will fantasize during sex. It's an extra trigger to increase your sexual arousal. So it's actually quite normal to fantasize about other partners, for example, when you have sex. We have addressed this in the previous episode that often when you are turning on each other and when you have in this phase of sexual desire, you're interacting with your partner. But at a certain point, when you want to reach orgasm, you need to sort of let go of your partner. And so at that point, what you see is that some people turn inwards and start to fantasize. And they can fantasize maybe about having sex with another person on a very exciting place. In a way, that's okay, because it's just a fantasy. It's just a way to enhance your sexual arousal. And that's what we often see, that these fantasies, especially women, tend to fantasize more. Men are more visually oriented. Yes. And I think that's why men often rely more on porn to sort of when masturbating, for example, of to increase sexual arousal than women.
Yeah, it's so true. I notice also, like, sometimes in bed, like, for the guy, like, to come, he has to, like, be with his eyes open, you know, and, like, looking and, like, watching the situation, what is happening in front of them. But, like, for me, just like you said, it's kind of like I'm enjoying, I'm there with the person, but when it's my turn, like, to shine, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, I kind of go inwards and, I have these little fantasies, like, and I just start thinking about things that excite me. And then it's so much beautiful, like, to be able to do that next to someone without any judgment, because there shouldn't be none. And you're just there vibing and, like, exploring your pleasure.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's really this. We see this little difference between men and women, that indeed men need this more visual stimuli. We have a man here among us.
More about that.
Do you recognize this idea?
Yeah, I was just wondering, because then also I haven't thought about it beforehand whether I need more or less visual stimuli than my female partner. But I think I also tend to have my eyes maybe more open. Also, I like to have eye contact. I think that's really a big
sexy
point. Sexy, and also gives more intimacy to look into the other's eye.
Yeah, but I think if we think about this visual orientation, I think that's one of the reasons why men often watch porn more. And when we think about this idea, this topic of am I normal, I think talking about porn is a very important topic because a lot of people watch porn. It's really available and it's easy available nowadays. Even also during COVID, we know that Pornhub, for example, has made its premium services for free so that people could better cope with the lockdown, obviously to attract more members. But at the same time, it really works. So a lot of people, the porn use has increased during COVID. And this is because, yeah, obviously, why do people use porn? Well, it's because boredom, because they want to cope with distress or just want curiosity, information seeking. So it's quite normal that in these times, your porn use has increased. So don't worry about it. But it comes to the question like, yeah, am I normal when I watch porn every day? I masturbate every day. So that's a question a lot of people are bothered with. And I think it really comes down to the question, are you still in control? If you feel that it's an uncontrollable urge, that it really interferes with your daily life, with study, work, relationships, social activities, then it becomes problematic. Mm-hmm. So if you're actually using it for emotion regulation, for example, that when you watch porn, you feel bad, you feel guilty and shame, and then this bad feeling becomes a trigger to watch porn again, then it means that you're not watching porn for the mere joy of it, but then you use it actually as a way to cope with negative emotions. Then it becomes an emotion regulation strategy. Yeah. And then you can say, okay, maybe then there's some kind of problematic issues going on.
During this COVID period, like sometimes it was kind of hard to find like sexual partners to explore good sex with. So I really did feel this kind of like sexual frustration sometimes. And I would either masturbate out of boredom or something like that, or to just like have this quick fix, like this quick dopamine release, like little reward kind of, you know? And I feel like that's kind of linked also to emotional regulation, but not in a pathological sense.
Exactly. Then. It's not a problem to use porn or to masturbate in a way to cope with negative emotions. We know that also during exam periods that people masturbate a lot or watch porn more because it's just a way to cope with the stress, to reduce your distress. So it does not need to be pathological if you use sex for not only for enjoyment or for orgasm. Orgasm can have a function, namely reducing distress. So that's not a problem. But it's more, it becomes pathological when there's this uncontrollable urge. Like, for example, that I always give this example when I teach also. Like, imagine that you thought, okay, tonight my roommate is out and so I'm going to watch porn. I'm going to masturbate the entire evening. And then suddenly you come home and your roommate says like, hey, my date is canceled. Let's go for a drink. How do you deal with that? Is it like, oh my God, I want to masturbate, I planned it the whole day and you get distressed? Or is it like, oh great, we're going for a drink and then you masturbate on another time? Mm-hmm. That makes a difference whether it's like uncontrollable urge or not, whether it does not interfere with your social life and with plans.
And I was wondering actually, because like I know that the data and like the studies are not very clear on this issue that we say hypersexuality, when someone like is has a sexual compulsion sometimes, and the data is not very clear on that, but I do know some cases where a certain like people's sexual behavior and sexual urges can affect their family, because it can break families sometimes.
Exactly.
And it can be very hard for children sometimes to grow up with parents in the household where they just can't control their sexual urges, or like bring a lot of people all the time and cheating and everything, like destroying family. So I really do wonder whether there is, to a certain extent, any kind of like sexual compulsion that becomes pathological, really, despite the data not being very clear.
Yeah, I think that's what you say, sexual compulsion. I think that there's not a lot of agreement on how we should label it. As some people say, hypersexuality, sex addiction has been labeled, sexual compulsive behavior is also one of the terms. And at this point, there's no agreement on, okay, what is it exactly? The research is really conflicted. And I think it's, I prefer the term hypersexuality. I don't like sex addiction or porn addiction or whatever, because it's not the same as an addiction like in drugs and alcohol. We also know it from research, from brain research, that it's not activating the same brain area. So it's something different. And it's exactly not always about the sex in itself. It's more about this low self-esteem, difficulties with emotion regulation. I think that is the biggest issue. And also, I think we should not regard it as a sex addiction, and it's certainly not treat it as a sex addiction, because there are these programs that rely on these 12 steps, like the same as the alcohol treatments. But you cannot be completely abstinent from sex. You can say, okay, stop, you cannot use any drugs anymore, you cannot drink any alcohol anymore, and then it's okay. But obviously with sex you cannot do that. I mean, sex is everywhere. It's really important about learning to enjoy sex again, because that's the issue. When people are like hypersexual, often it's like this urge, this uncontrollable, they feel bad about it, so they're not actually enjoying sexuality. Also, when they compulsively watch porn and masturbate, they're not enjoying it. So it's really important that they learn to enjoy it again and learn to control their behavior. So you could say, like, you know, select the 5 most interesting pornographic movies, and then you masturbate mindfully every other day, and the other day you need to control it. But when you masturbate, enjoy it, so that you sort of learn to enjoy the sexual stimulation again. And at the same time, working on positive ego strengthening activities, making you feel better about yourself. I think that is an important way. It's not taking something away, but it's offering something positive and making that there's a positive association between sex and sexual feelings again. I think that is important. And at this point, there are some treatments not really working, and because they're really focusing on abstinence and control. And I think this is not what we need to target.
But how do you then balance the thin line of healthy sex use when you used to be really hypersexual in that sense? So you say you cannot compare to alcoholism or other kind of addictions, because with alcohol you often see this rapid reacquisition. If someone who has been abstinent drinks once, he starts getting into a binge of alcohol again. With sex, is that I also imagine that those years of habituation of just doing it for this orgasm or for this emotion regulation, then against this one time trying to really feel what you're doing and to really be in the moment, can also be difficult to fight against these years of conditioning.
Exactly. I think you're completely right, because there could be some kind of sexual desensitization that you need increasingly more sexual arousing stimuli to get this the sexual arousal. So you need to sort of desensitize yourself again. And I think that's indeed an issue, and that's a challenge of treatment. And it's what you say, there's really a thin line between, like, okay, what is now normal or not like controllable sexual behavior and uncontrollable sexual behavior. And I think that's why at this point hypersexuality, for example, is not an official psychiatric or sexual dysfunction or diagnosis, because at this point there's the risk that we are going to pathologize normal sexual behavior, and that's why people don't want to treat it as a sexual dysfunction. But at the same time, it's like you say, there are enough examples of or cases of people who are clearly hypersexual, and that it's really interfering with their daily life, with their relationships, with family
and
life.
With others, affecting others. And the thing you were saying about, like, sex addiction and abstinence, a thing that I really can't understand is these anonymous groups, the sex addicts, they call themselves, and they're like, they get these badges, I haven't had sex for 6 months now, like, I'm getting healed. I don't think that is actually, like, helping in any way. I feel like, knowing that it's linked to emotional regulation or a lack of, we have to help those people work on other spheres of their life and not really just sex, you know. Maybe the sex is just a byproduct of other instabilities that they have in their life. So just going there and saying, okay, from now on, if you want to get better, you have to just completely stop having sexual interactions. Can't even masturbate, basically. Anything. And that's so bad. Like, let's start from the root. Sex education, for example, already, like, I think it's so linked to that, right? People who didn't learn how to regulate and, like, have their boundaries also, and, like, didn't have a super healthy, if we could say, like, sexual development as children, teenagers, and young adults.
Yeah,
then
exactly. Yeah.
Do you think that people can also do that from home? So not only going, if you had those kind of emotion regulation issues that then end up in a lot of sex or masturbation. Do you think you can also from home tackle those issues? Also talking now about maybe COVID times, or do you think that professional help?
I think is that often it depends really on how far you are in this cascade of hypersexual behavior. But I think that obviously treatment works. I mean, if you work with a sexologist and can help to sort of discover, like, okay, that you need to learn to that sex can be a resource, that it's not only a way of coping with negative emotions, and so you need to deal with these underlying negative emotions. Where do they come from? This low self-esteem, and they kind of, why do they engage in this type of behavior to deal with these negative emotions? Are there alternative ways to deal with negative emotions? So you need to sort of go to the core of the meaning of this behavior and what the underlying reasons are. And it's kind of sometimes difficult to do that on yourself, because often you don't know it yourself. And it's like through therapy that you can discover what you're actually, what is the meaning and the function of this behavior in your personal life. So, but I think it's just also awareness is already a first step, and that you can sort of already at home just try to discover, okay, what is, why am I watching porn? Why am I masturbating? Is this uncontrollable or not? Is this an urge? Am I sort of trying to soothe some negative emotions, and is this becoming dysfunctional? Just trying to question yourself is already, I think, an important first step. Yeah.
No, definitely. I feel like, for example, there has been some points in life where I found myself being so ridiculous, kind of like, because I just couldn't stop. I was always seeking this kind of like sexual behavior and everything, until, as you said, we need this awareness, and you have to be conscious that maybe you want to change something. I think it has to come from within, kind of like, this is like taking too much space in my like daily life. I'm thinking about this so often that I need to do something about this. And then, yeah, through journaling, for example, for me, I started journaling, trying to ask myself, like, why do I feel like I need to interact sexually with other people? I have to be looking for partners that I don't even know sometimes. And for me, like, I was feeling very bad that I depended so much on other people for my own well-being. Yep. So through self-regulation, journaling, even like doing some jogging, sports and everything, I kind of got the same feeling of satisfaction that I used to have after a couple of hours with someone that I didn't like that much, to be honest.
Yeah, it's really about self-reflection. And it's like you say, it's going back to the core, like, why am I doing it? And are there alternative ways to get this feeling? Mm. And I think that is one of the important things when it comes to hypersexuality. But it's really important that at this point, the research is really giving conflicting evidence, and there are so many things to discover yet, because it could be, of course, that there's also more sexual excitation, that they're more sensation seeking, that people are more like sexually arousable, that these people are more vulnerable to engage in hypersexual behavior. Yeah. So it probably is not only about regulating negative emotions. There are probably also some personality traits that make you more sensitive and more vulnerable to engage in this type of behavior. So I think at this point it's a field that needs more research to really understand what is hypersexuality about. But at this, I think one of the most important things is that I don't think we should completely level it with an addiction or just label it as an addiction, because it's much more with compulsion and emotion regulation. Yeah.
And we shouldn't see sex as like, oh, there's like a norm for sex also, because just like you said, it also has to do with your inhibition and excitation. Like, someone who has a higher sexual inhibition system, like compared to a sexual excitation system, might think that they have a problem, for example, when it's just them. It's like individual differences. Like, maybe my excitation system is like way higher than my inhibition one, and that makes me just more prone to, like, I don't know, more prone to go
more
to
more
those interactions.
More sensation seeking in terms of sexuality, yeah.
Yeah, and I also think that when it comes to labeling it as an addiction or not, if you look at other uses, for example, for drugs are not natural needs, and drugs, then you can have a parameter where you say, from this point onwards, it's pathological, it's not good anymore. But with sex, again, being a natural need that you cannot get rid of, as you said, and also being so different for everyone, you cannot say if you have X amount of time of sex in this time period, then it's good or not good anymore, normal or not normal, because it's such so individual.
Now, when we were talking about hypersexuality, what is also interesting is that there's a clear gender differences, that it occurs more in men. And in a way, if we think about gender differences and we're talking about porn, we also see that there's a clear gender gap in porn use, that men, there are like about 75% of men will use porn, and about 25% in women. So it's clearly that porn is more used by men, but you can also see that the porn industry has been developed for men. Mm. It's really targeting also the sexual pleasure of the men if you look at porn movies. And it's also because, well, men habituate very fast to sexual stimuli. So when you repeatedly present the same sexual stimulus to a man, their sexual arousal will decrease rapidly. Mm. Like in women, it's the same, but it's less. And so that's why men need more variety in sexual stimuli. And so the porn industry has been developed to sort of meet this variety. Mm. And this explains why, porn has originally been developed a lot for men, and that men watch porn more than women. But at the same time, it does not mean that women are not visually oriented, that they do not watch porn. But it could be that women will more like listen to erotic stories or read erotic books, like
Fifty Shades of Grey,
for example, was very popular and was less popular in men. So there seems to be a clear gender difference in terms of porn use.
I also wonder whether it's linked to the fact that for men, the female orgasm, it's like this big mystery, you know, like how to really, really please a woman. Like, it's very hard because it's like the vagina and you don't really see the clitoris if you don't know how to see it or you don't know how to look for it, you know. So you kind of like also watch porn out of curiosity to like learn
exactly
the movements or like how to even like do a cunnilingus and things like that. But for girls, maybe it's more straightforward, this idea of having sex. They know it's mainly, I guess, about the penetration nowadays. Like, that's how people tend to see it. Of course, it can be like way more than that, but the basic idea is like that penetration would lead to a male orgasm at least. So I wonder if it's linked also to that curiosity from like the men's
obviously
side.
Obviously, I think that people just want to learn and porn is a good way to learn sex. That's one thing. But it's indeed, I mean, when you think if you want to learn from porn, you get a very uniform picture of what sex is. It's often focused on male sexual pleasure. So it's about blowjobs and it's about penetration. And then we see that for women, this is less exciting. There is nowadays more female-friendly porn, like the porna, and then it's more about the context, the stimulus, the touching. It's about female sexual pleasure being more central. It's also like normal-looking actresses without the silicone breasts and the porn pussies and the tribal tattoos. Mm. So it's more like realistic porn, and the women like that more. They like also that there's more like a story instead of the hard porn in itself. So there's clearly a difference in what men and women like in type of porn. But at this point, I think that the porn industry has evolved and that there's more like different types of porn sort of to address these different needs in terms of porn.
Nicole, I was wondering, like, what kind of porn would you like enjoy watching more?
I think when I started watching porn, I think I was around 14 years old. I was just clicking this porn button and illegally entering the site, clicking on this enter button was really exciting, and just seeing naked bodies, because I hit puberty, all those hormones are coming up, and just really excited by just the pictures, and the videos are even more exciting. And then for me, I think I also watched a bit of this, a bit of that, different categories. And yeah, nowadays I don't really watch that much porn anymore.
You had it. You've been there, done that.
Think when we talked about before and about this emotional regulation, I think that when I was a teenager, I maybe used it also for a bit of emotional regulation, and just felt at some point also after masturbating, I felt a bit of guilt and not that it did too much good for me. So I kind of, it's not that I entirely don't watch porn anymore, but I just don't really watch it that much anymore.
But I think it's important that we shouldn't feel guilty about watching porn, because sometimes this guilt and shame is also because that's the moral judgment from our societal norms about watching porn, that it's kind of pathological, or especially like when you're in a relationship, you cannot watch porn. As I said before, the porn industry has evolved to meet this need for variety. So actually, there's no harm. I mean, it's very normal, like in a relationship, that at a certain point, also the your own partner, I mean, you habituate to the sex with your own partner. So it's a good way to sort of bring some variety. It can give you some inspiration to experiment, to use different types of sexual behavior. It's like you say, you also discover your own sexual interests. And you say, like, I had different types of porn and I discovered different categories. Yeah. So it's also a good way to learn yourself better, to understand, like, hey, I'm getting aroused by this type of porn or by this type of porn. And it's kind of a discovery. So I think it's very normal in adolescence that you're watching porn because you're very curious. And young people in the midst of their sexual development, they are very receptive to all types of information. So it's quite obvious that if you can enter these sex sites, that you will look and that you will sort of be curious. I think that's very normal.
Especially for young people, the novelty seeking is like extremely high at that point. Like everything's new for you. So like everything's so interesting and you just want to like dig deeper and discover. Yeah. Basically.
But at the same time, if we think about that, you already addressed it, like, yeah, when you were younger, you entered this porn site in a way that's, it should be, you should be 18 plus, but at this point it's really difficult to regulate that. But we have to think about like, okay, what are the consequences if you're 12 or 13 years old, you don't know about sex and then you watch porn. So if we think about the effects of porn on sexual development, there's also research is not free of moral judgment because we always automatically assume it's going to be negative. And in a way you could say, well, if you look at the male-oriented classic porn, you could say that the women are kind of objectified. They are the lust object of the man. Mm. It's really about the male sexual pleasure. So it could confirm gender stereotypes. It could be that people watching porn a lot will endorse these rape myths and are more permissive attitudes regarding sexual violence. They consider sex without love is very common. Yes. They start to copy the sexual acts they see in the movies because they don't know what sex is. So at a certain point, there can be some miseducation because, for example, women think I need to squirt, or young guys think, well, I need to climax on her belly, I need to ejaculate in her face because that's what they see, so they kind of copy it. So yeah, there are some risks involved. I agree that if you're young and you get all this information, what is the impact on sexual development?
Yeah, that's a very good question, but I wanted to say something very interesting is that in one of the courses that I had in psychology, like the forensic one, I did it with Canada while I was doing this Erasmus kind of thing, exchange. And in the course of forensics, we had this chapter on sexual offenders, and they saw that there's a big link, like a big correlation with porn usage. And they saw that those that sexual harassment, rape, and things like that, they report having used porn in a compulsive manner when they were growing up. It's like they were isolated for so long and just watching porn, and one day they turned to interpersonal violence. That's what I mean, the link to interpersonal violence.
Indeed, it's just a way that people are portrayed in this porn industry can be problematic, and I think that's also why women don't like porn, is that they often question themselves, is this female actress really enjoying this? Because it's so much focused on the blowjob and the penetration and so on. And I think that's important that people see this. And I don't know whether if you reflect on your own sexual development and when you watch porn, do you think that it affected your thinking and sexual behavior?
I think definitely, because I think it was, I started watching porn before I first had sex. So, and then as a child or as an adolescent, young adolescent, I don't think you question or reflect everything that you see. You just see, and maybe you mimic also, you get a false sense of what you should do. You think you ought to do the things you see there. So yeah, I think then it also took time again to then later go back from this outwards, what I see in porn, what I think is normal, to seeing what I really want and what is best. And also I think what in a lot of porn is missing, because it's just this fantasy world of really hyper stimuli, is this connection between the people kind of. It's more porn, those professional porn movies sometimes seem more like business, as you say. They have those different practices they do, and it all has to be so strong and so exaggerated. So then also to go back to myself then, when I first experienced sex, and see what do I really want, and do people have to moan so loud that the neighbors would hear it, or can it just also be enjoyable the way I enjoy it, and that is not related to how they do it there.
But could you talk about other people, about what you see? Because I think that's also important. Mm-hmm. You say like, hey, you're like 15, you watch porn, and is there somebody who can sort of tell you like, hey, this is not realistic what you're seeing, or this is not the real sex? Like, can you talk about it with your parents or in sex educational programs? Or
I think the only exchange I had was with boys in my age also. When I was 14, 15, I also didn't talk to girls about it, but only my boys' peer group. And they were also kind of in the same boat. So you were just mirroring each other's behavior. And I think to really, until I really reflected on what I'm doing was after I finished school, 18, 19, 20 maybe, beforehand, no. And also the sex education I experienced in school was more about how to use a condom. There was once a woman for 1 hour putting a condom over a banana, and that was it.
Yeah, that's terrible. We still need to work on that because I think it's so important. I've talked about this in previous episodes, how important it is to talk as parents also with your children about sex, because at that point, if you follow your child into their sexual development and you have an open communication, then you can sort of give them some your own ideas and morals and talk about consent in terms of sexuality, talk about how sexuality is also about love and about touching each other and about intimacy and sharing this intimacy and putting some kind of also more realistic image like, hey, what you see, that's really interesting. And obviously you can get inspiration. It's not bad to watch porn. You can get a lot of inspiration from it and learn from it. And I know that also people learn about sexual anatomy. And also, if we think about young people, it can promote the conversation, an open conversation about sexuality. You learn to experiment. Mm-hmm. And also, when we talk about sex education, it's quite heteronormative. So for young people in a same-sex relationship or gender-diverse adolescents, they actually, they get information from the internet. Obviously, they watch porn because that's the way they get informed. If you look at the sex education they get at school, it's always about a male partner and a female partner, so they have questions, so obviously they're turned to the internet. So I think the internet in general, but porn and all these websites on sexuality can be very informative and can also be an important source of information. But I think it's really important that we work on these websites and work on also websites that can sort of nuance the things people see at porn, so that it can that people can benefit from the
Definitely. I at least I really enjoy watching porn even nowadays, and I never watch heteronormative porn, like heterosexual. Like my partners are usually males, but the porn that I watch is lesbian porn, like because I just really like the connection that women show there, and there's as you said, that component of heteronormativity is not that much there, which I really enjoy. Is more free, more these feelings and connections and like taking care of the other, and not just this penetration, which we know that most of the times it's not just a lot of arousement during the penetration. So for me, like, porn was definitely, it played a big role in my sexual development, but I didn't take everything that I saw as for granted. I think it's very important to be critical in what you see and recognize that, okay, like, you can watch sloppy sex if you want to, like a video that you would never tell anyone that you just watched, you know, like it's really for you and yourself, but it's fun, you know, like it's fun to watch that from time to time, a bit of novelty. As long as you don't take it as the norm, you know, like, okay, now I have to do like this all the time and things like that.
Yeah, exactly. An interesting thing what you say is that you use it to discover yourself and to sort of learn like what turns me on and in terms of sexual arousal. And I clearly see there's also a difference, a gender difference in porn use, in the sense that men use it more to arouse themselves during masturbation. We see that women indeed use it more to understand their body better, but also they like to watch porn together with their partner. They use it kind of as a part of to get into the mood for sex with the partner, to use it as part of seduction and foreplay. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why if we think about porn, we should not only focus on the solo, watching solo porn, but you can also watch together with your partner.
Definitely.
And that can have also a lot of positive functions for the relationships. But again, if we think about the research, automatically assumes negative effects in the sense that it would increase the risk of relationship breakup and promote infidelity, and that at a certain point people it would induce unrealistic expectations or raise the concern that watching porn would be more interesting than having sex with the partner, so that it becomes a substitute for partner sex. Or and also one of the hypotheses is that it would cause sexual desensitization, that we talked about, that at a certain point you need increasingly more intense stimuli to get sexually aroused. So at a certain point, sex with the actual partner becomes less stimulating. It's not stimulating enough and would then induce erectile problems. Yeah. So there's often kind of risks, like also that there's a discrepancy between having sex with your partner and then indeed seeing this very much passion and this woman climaxing like for 5 minutes. And it's like, oh, my partner is not doing this. Mm. So there's something wrong.
So I think that shows like really the importance of normalizing fantasies, you know, fantasizing, you know, there's no wrong at all in that. And actually, it's so fun when you're able to do that and feel free to do that also like in bed and or with your partner watching porn together, you know, like that can be also a little kinky fantasy and you're just fulfilling it and it's fun, you know, to a certain extent. And I don't know, I would think that the couples that watch porn together would actually have less chances of like getting involved in cheating and things like that.
Because indeed you sort of suit this need for variety.
Like you explore, you go like a little bit out of this box, you know, kind of normative sex, I would say. Because we've seen also like with the like pedophilia, for example, there are the passive pedophiles who don't do anything. They're just normal people. And yes, okay, because of their development somewhere in their life, you know, it became like that they are attracted to children, but they recognize the wrongdoings in that. They recognize the potential of harm to children. So they don't engage in those acts, but they don't engage then in any sexual act because they would like with children. So they stay in their own bubble and don't hurt anyone, yet there's so much hatred, you know, for people who are just fantasizing and not doing anything.
Yeah.
And then we see that for those who are like, who try to fantasize at first, but the fantasy gets to a certain degree so strong that they feel like they have to act on it to fulfill that fantasy. Most of the times, they actually regret acting on that fantasy because it wasn't fulfilled like the fantasies inside of their heads, right?
Indeed. Yeah, so you could say that watching porn is just a way of fantasizing and learning and experimenting, and also in relationships it can have a positive function. So I think that is important to what we also sometimes see, that when we look at the negative effects of porn use, that it's not the viewing, the act of viewing itself, but it's often when there's a discrepancy that one partner is using porn and the other is not, and when they don't know, when they do it behind each other's back. So I think that's why it's important to have this open communication and just talk. Maybe you don't feel like watching porn, but it's okay if your partner watches porn, that you can openly talk about it and don't see this as a threat to your relationship. And also try to see, okay, how can we benefit from porn? Because it's out there, it's available. So I always have this idea, like when it's out there, just be curious and look at it. And maybe it's nothing for you, and maybe you don't like it, but maybe you can explore, like, are there any types of porn that I like? And it can really help you to deal with frustrations when there's discrepancies in sexual desire, when your partner's not available, that you sort of need a trigger to masturbate or to sort of increase your sexual arousal, or to deal with sexual anxieties and promote sexual autonomy, or to experiment, to also open the conversation with your partner. If you watch porn together, that you can sort of say, hey, could we try this out? Or would you like this? Won't you like this? So you learn from each other. Maybe you don't act on the behaviors you see, but you can sort of learn what the other wants, what the other don't want. And so it can be very beneficial. We actually use it a lot in therapy, that we advise couples with sexual problems to watch porn. Because you can learn, it can help you to broaden your sexual script. It can give you inspiration, and especially it can help you to talk about sex.
Definitely. And I think it's by putting this watching porn and like talking about it with your partner, we are actually confining this porn usage that could be healthy to the hidden realms of like its hidden spheres of life. And that's, I think, what creates this feeling of, oh, I'm getting cheated on because him or her is watching porn, because you don't talk about it, you know. So of course there is, to a certain degree, you're hiding something, so I understand where the hurt stems from. But I think that then we should really like normalize talking about this. And it's part of our lives.
It's about talking about it and just agreeing. I can imagine that it's not fun, but when you come home and you see your partner watching porn and is masturbating, maybe you don't want to see it. Could be. But at the same time, don't ignore it or don't get stressed, because we do see that a lot of people feel like, oh, my partner is watching porn and masturbating. Is there something wrong in my relationship? And it's just because they think that at a certain point a partner will prefer watching porn rather than having sex with them, or that they have this idea like, I cannot meet up. It can create performance demand. They're like, oh, these perfect actresses, and they're like very reach orgasm very easily, and they're always enjoying it, and I'm not like that, and so my partner will start to expect this from me. So there's a lot about this performance demand that is induced by watching porn. But I think it's really important just not to feel threatened by it, because there's clearly a difference. Like you say, it's kind of a fantasy. It's like that's the porn, and sort of having sex with your partner is still about intimacy, and so it's something completely different. But we do see that this idea of watching porn in a relationship is very still an issue. I don't know if you talk about this with friends or in your own relationship.
I think nowadays I'm quite fine with talking to friends about porn, or also if I'm in a relationship, hence also why I'm here today. But
talking about porn with friends, like I do, because I'm like I super open about that, and I love talking about sex with friends, like, you know, like Nicola, like we're very good friends and we love talking about sex together and things like that. And sometimes I do ask my friends, you know, do you watch porn? And but I see that those that are in a relationship, they don't at all. But when I say at all, is at all.
But maybe they also don't dare to watch porn because they think if I watch porn, that's not okay.
They kind of like tell me like, oh, I'm good, I have a man, you know, like I'm fulfilled. Okay, but I don't think it's like related, you know what I mean? Like you can be fulfilled but still enjoy
watching
porn.
It's a different type of sexual exploration, of sexual behavior. I think it's really important, but we have to be careful not to create new norms again, because if you're thinking about so normal, then it feels like everyone needs to watch porn, and if you're in a relationship, watch porn. No, obviously not. I mean, I just think it's interesting to explore it because it's there and that you can see what does it does. And obviously there are people who don't like porn. That's okay.
Yeah.
It's really about, I think, when we talk about the question, am I normal? It's really difficult to give an answer because we have to create our own norms. And I think you just, again, need to just reflect on yourself. Like, do I feel okay about it? If you don't feel distressed, if you're not hurting yourself and others, then it's okay. Mm-hmm. I mean, just let's create your own norms. I think that's the most important message we want to give today.
No, definitely, definitely.
Okay. Well, thank you for this interesting conversation.
Yeah. Well,
thank you.
Thank you all for listening. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.